Together, they form a caravan of blazing colors, joined by one common bond: high-speed madness on a bicycle. But the will to win can only be found alone, and from deep inside. Time is all that matters here. The man who can stay ahead of the rest rides with the yellow jersey, which as his golden fleece only teases those who attempt to snatch it off his back. The man hunt for the yellow jersey builds a junkyard filled with broken bikes and shattered dreams. This is the Tour de France. For the men who race it and the millions who watch it, it's the most magnificent sporting event in the world. How wonderfully tranquil is the French countryside that invites it, and how perfectly devilish is the course that serves up the most grueling bicycle race in the world. I'm John Tesh, and welcome to our second week of coverage of the Tour de France bicycle race. You know, the Tour has been described many ways, but most of all, it's a celebration by the millions of these people out here who seem to come from nowhere each year to line the streets of France to cheer their heroes of bicycle racing. Each day, it's a different race. One day, it might be a time trial, which is a race against the watch, or an all-out sprint, or a hill climb up the side of an Alp. 2,567 long miles over 23 days. And as you may already know, the winner of this whole thing is the man who completes the entire course in the fastest overall elapsed time. Oddly enough, one of the men who's picked to win this year is American Greg LeMond. And for more on that, here's a veteran of 13 Tours de France, Phil Liggett.
Greg LeMond now knows he really can win this Tour de France, but he has two very strange problems. One, of course, his own teammate, Bernard Hinault, four times winner. The other is down the street neighbour, Phil Anderson. And like LeMond, Anderson has been forced to leave his native country to come into Europe and make his fortune. But you know, all three could be on the finish podium in Paris. It's a question of which order.
And the decision on who would wear yellow first was made on day one, the prologue time trial in the heart of Brittany. In the start house, 27-year-old Australian Phil Anderson knew the prologue would serve notice to he and his rivals as to the strength of Phil Anderson in this year's tour. The Belgians call the time trial the race of truth, and it's aptly named. This race was only 4 miles long, but Anderson and 24-year-old American Greg LeMond knew the wait in the start house was a countdown to the lonely and painful ride alone without the help of teammates. Teammate Frenchman Bernard Hinault, with the concentration of a man who last year won this, the Tour's first race. Like LeMond, Hinault wore an aerodynamic helmet, his lightweight bike stripped down and fashioned with a solid rear wheel to knife through the wind and steal precious seconds from the unforgiving clock. For his effort, the Australian Anderson would finish the prologue 19 seconds behind the leader. Greg LeMond found himself tugged along by the screams of fans who cheered this hero from another country. But these fanatics of bike racing reserve their final outrageous pleas for a victory for the cyclist they have named the Badger, Bernard Hinault. At the summit, and Greg LeMond's finish would leave him 21 seconds back in the overall lead. It was, of course, Bernard Hinault who established the best time in the race of truth, and his Claire team jersey was replaced by one of yellow to mark him as the Tour's overall leader. So, four-time champion was first to lead 179 cyclists in a race that has used the same playing field since 1891. The specific route of the Tour de France changes every year, and this year, the Tour actually remained in a part of the country in which Bernard Hinault grew up, Brittany. As the riders travel along France's north coast, the racing is basically over flatlands, on into the town of Vitré. By now, they have traveled 300 miles, and the finish line in Paris is well over 2,200 miles away. But instead of the Champs-Élysées, it's time to think of the cobblestone roads that await them on the way to the textile town of Roubaix near the Belgian border. If riding over cobblestones isn't mad enough, well, the Alps now loom in the distance. The tour snakes along the borders of four countries on the way to a crucial time trial in Strasbourg before reaching Épinal. Now comes the part of the tour riders like Greg LeMond enjoy. This is where the climbing begins. After a trip into Switzerland for about an hour and a half, it's time now to see who can climb and who cannot. And the Alps will provide the answer to that question quite easily. The Alps and then the Pyrenees mountain races will take the cyclists straight up into ski resorts and then straight down at speeds of 60 miles an hour. History tells us that the top two or three riders have been culled from the pack by now, so as they head back north to those vineyards of Bordeaux, the racing is frenzied as those behind are chasing madly. And the man in front tries to take his yellow jersey on to Paris to hear the hundreds of thousands of fans lining the Champs-Élysées scream his name. The man who can survive and then triumph becomes the champion of this 23-day, 2,567-mile bike race. And who are these men who could pedal into the history books? The family man, 24 years young, Gregory James LeMond, proud father and past world champion, now living and training in Belgium and conquering a sport certainly not yet this popular in America. Pick up any paper or magazine this time of year in Europe, and you'll see a lot of this son of a railway worker, 30-year-old Bernard Hinault, who specializes in whipping the best bike racers in the world and making a fortune doing it. Winning the 1,000-mile tour of Switzerland 1 month ago is reason enough for Australian Phil Anderson to be smiling over his health food. Anderson also left his native land to train in Belgium and does so with his neighbor, Greg LeMond. In the tour, the two ride on rival teams. Lots of smiles on the faces of this year's favorites, but the tour has a way of changing things. The toll of 23 days at 100 miles a day. The crush of the international press, just about the time you'd like to catch your breath. And a bout with fatigue that renders you helpless.
Made a better beginning. His own teammate, Greg LeMond, is only 21 seconds behind, and the young American makes a formidable ally for Hinault. But the Tour de France is all about team tactics, and the Panasonic team demonstrates early on that they intend to take the lead today after all. Phil Anderson, the Australian, is their leader, but today the man they call the Kangaroo is sharing his stardom with Belgian teammate Eric van der Aarden. Although he wears a special green jersey, he's still part of the boys in blue and white. And while Anderson concentrates on the pace and saves energy for the week ahead, the team joins forces to help van der Aarden, and it makes an awesome show of strength. Further back is Olympic silver medalist Steve Bauer in his first ever tour, and his first job, to help his leader Bernard Hinault regain his place at the front of the pack. But for today at least, the Panasonic Express will not be stopped, and that means the Belgian Eric van der Aarden will wear yellow.
So Eric van der Aarden in yellow, signing autographs and enjoying the star status as the tour's leader. But wait a minute here, van der Aarden, although he's a competent cyclist, is not expected to hold the lead. He's actually been hired on the Panasonic team to help the team's number one rider to a victory. That man is Phil Anderson. And in a race where teamwork is very important, Anderson depends on his nine other riders to help him win the tour.
You deserve it.
Here's Eric Heiden with some more.
Thanks.
In the 23 days of the Tour de France, no one can win it alone. Each rider out here is on a team, and each team has its stars, which means that each team also has its slaves. These are the dispensable riders the French call domestiques. They're the water boys for the team leaders and will willingly sacrifice themselves so the stars can win.
Hey.
It's 6:30 a.m. and Theo de Roy appears in his real-life soap opera. The star on the door may be a joke, but the significance is real.
Time to get out of there.
For the Dutchman, professional cycling is a very real job. As a domestique, he is the servant of a man who can win the tour. Even as they ride to the start area, his job is looking after number one, who is always someone else.
You always have to look at the top rider, for example, Phil Anderson. He's not too much in his nose. In case he punctures, a few riders have to wait to bring him back to the group, to the bunch.
His job is to get me to the finish of the stage and to Paris. Without using too much of my energy, my own resources.
Do you ever hope that someday there'll be a domestique working for you?
Well, I'm 28 now, so I'm riding 6 years professional now, and I know what my possibilities are and where my weak points are, and I'll never be the chief of a team. That's for sure.
Father of three and a college graduate, Theo has resigned himself to be one of the Indians, and as such is one of the lowest paid members on the totem pole. He makes $25,000 a year as compared to someone like Phil Anderson, who can expect five times as much. Nevertheless, you have to be a great warrior to survive on one of the world's great cycling teams. On a hot and sunny day, one of the first jobs for a domestique is to go back to the team car for food and water for the stars. Carrying water bottles wherever possible, even down the backs of their jerseys, they know success is often measured by the amount they can deliver at one time.
When the star breaks down, life becomes kind of busy for the workers. Here, by working together, the servants pull them on back to the safety of the pack, and without him using hardly any energy at all. Drafting behind another rider can save as much as 30% of effort, and that, measured over 3 weeks, can mean the difference between yellow and nothing. And while Lamont chases back, Eno has a strategy chat.
The Panasonic domestiques, who have controlled the race thus far, have run out of gas and now must work extra hard just to keep up with the rest of the pack.
Remember Kim Anderson, the water carrier? He now has a new role to play, and here he is leading a breakaway group. The stars, Bernard Eno and Greg LeMond, are happy to have a team man out in front. Don't forget, domestiques can win too. So while the stars of the race keep an eye on one another, paced of course by a domestique, Anderson's breakaway will succeed. And because he has the best overall time of the group, Anderson the worker takes on yet another new role, that of carrying the burden of the yellow jersey. The stars themselves, with 2,000 miles to go, aren't quite ready yet to move in.
So wearing the yellow jersey makes Kim Anderson a marked man, with the rest of the stars conserving their energy. And now it's time for those stars and workers like Theo de Roy to get some rest.
So you're under a lot of stress every day. So when you are on the table having a massage, you're very satisfied.
So a day in the life of the domestique. And after one night's rest, this real-life soap opera will be back on the roads in the Tour de France. Really, but cobblestones joined together by dirt and weeds. Here in July, the people of France wait for what the cobbles will soon bring. They know their favorites. They know their names, their numbers, and their task ahead. Yeah! The roads that once carried the armies of Napoleon now turn a bicycle race into a raging nightmare on two wheels. Today, the Tour de France will pull its riders through l'enfer du Nord, the hell of the North. Bernard Hinault, a man who once said he'd never race over cobblestones again in his life, had to change his mind for a chance to win his fifth Tour. Kim Anderson, the smiling domestique, is the Tour's overall leader. So day six of 23, and time for another 149 miles over the flat roads of the North and the patches of cobblestones. What about those cobbles?
Sometimes it could be where you win or lose a race. If you lose 4 or 5 minutes, which is easy on cobblestones, you can lose a Tour de France. Be careful.
We're in Neuchâtel-en-Bray in the Normandy section of France, where the population of 6,000 would all appear to be cycling fans. And as they watch these men in their brightly colored jerseys roll out of town, you can bet they'll be dashing inside to watch live on French TV what happens when these cyclists reach those cobblestones. Before this race began, the cyclists had covered 521 miles with only 2,046 left to go.
And on a day that the riders fear perhaps as much as the mountains which still lie ahead, the sunshine and smooth roads disguise the face of the devil. Le Monde will find no protection behind the dark glasses, and Hinault, who hates the cobbles, can expect none behind his young teammate. In the hell of northern France, the cobbles defy team tactics, and every man will survive, or not, on his own initiative. The kangaroo, Phil Anderson, his domestique providing a windbreak, now fuels up for the journey. The Panasonic leader must prove himself and make the trip into hell personally. But there's always the spoilers, and two riders thought not to have a chance steal a 19-minute lead, and new professional Turn Von Vliet has visions of glory. So he sets a pace that Henri Manders is happy to follow. The pack proceeds with caution because, as most of them know, there's no good reason to rush into hell.
There's really no hurry. The cobblestones will wait. Van Vliet and Manders are the first to ride this roller coaster, comfortable only with their 19-minute time advantage. But these two up front only feed the hunger of the pack behind. Manders and Van Vliet still up front, behind them, the fury of the chasing pack. And suddenly, the beast is awakened in l'enfer du Nord. With the insane race pace comes the inevitable, and even the roads between the patches of cobblestones are treacherous. How can you win a bike race that won't even let you finish? Chasing group of cyclists to escape the falls have, like locusts, begun to devour the lead of Manders and Van Vliet. But for now, these two youngsters are trying to run away with the Tour de France. But will the best of the rest in the world let them get away with it? The gap begins to close. Do the men riding up front with such youthful abandon know their time in the lead is growing shorter? And look at Van Vliet. Is that the face of a man who thinks he can win? The two leaders who once held that 19-minute advantage is now becoming clear. The Panasonics, led by Domestique Théo de Roy, pulls the pack along. The first to be absorbed by the pack. But Manders still has something left and will go on to win the day's race. But because the tour is based on overall elapsed time, Kim Anderson retains the yellow jersey as he brings himself and the pack to within 11 seconds of Manders. Anderson returns to his chores as Domestique, as Manders goes on to win his first race in the Tour de France. And so this day ends pretty much as it began, apart from a frightening trip through the hell of the north. So the standings in the Tour de France after 6 days of 23, all of the top riders still very close. As American Greg LeMond sees it, those standings are encouraging.
I think I have the potential to win this race this year or even next year, but I really feel great right now. I mean, I really feel good. And so we'll just have to wait and see who's the strongest.
We'll rejoin John in France in just a moment. And still to come, John Madden's journeys with a look at owning your own franchise. But right now, Tim Ryan is standing by live in Las Vegas to set the stage for today's big title fight between Julio Cesar Chavez and Roger Mayweather. Tim?
That should be an exciting super featherweight championship. I think that Julio Cesar Chavez might be the best kept secret in boxing. He won the vacant title when the better known Hector Camacho moved up into the lightweight ranks. And he has proven himself to be a very worthy champion indeed. Look at that record. Unbeaten in 44 starts, turned pro at the age of 17, 38 knockouts along the way. And in his first title defense against the experienced Ruben Castillo, he scored a very impressive sixth round knockout and says he's not at all worried about fighting on foreign soil in Mayweather's hometown.
No, porque todo el tiempo he peleado fuera de.
No, I'm used to fighting outside of my country.
Roger Mayweather looking to gain back a world title. He is the former WBA champion, lost that crown to Rocky Lockridge, has only two defeats, has won his last three in a row, and looked very impressive in a third-round stoppage against Kenny Bazemore in his last outing. This was for the U.S. championship. Mayweather feeling he is the man that can handle the very tough champion from Mexico, Julio Cesar Chavez. It is coming up here on CBS Sports Sunday. Let's take you back now to Pat O'Brien in New York.
All right, Tim, thank you. We're looking forward to that fight. But meantime, there's another battle royale raging in France. It's a battle on wheels. We'll have more of that after this word from your local station. Stay with us.
Thank you.
many people who believe this race here on day 9 will be the most significant in this year's Tour de France. It's a time trial, which is a race against the clock alone. None of your teammates can help you while you're racing. By the time each one of the riders reaches the finish line here in Strasbourg, they will have traveled 45 miles, which not incidentally is the longest time trial distance in the last 24 years of the Tour de France. A man who knows this race very well is my colleague, U.S. Pro Cycling Champion Eric Heiden, who's at the starting gate.
The key to a long time trial like this one is to somehow break through that barrier of pain, and it always seems that you have to conquer that wall within the first few miles as you search for your pace. But once you find the rhythm, you can relax a little bit as long as you concentrate on keeping pressure on the pedals. This race is 45 miles, which means you can gain or lose a tremendous amount of time depending on how you feel. The time trial is Bernard Hinault's forte, which means Greg LeMond will have to ride the race of his life if he wants to take that yellow jersey.
Well, another man who would dearly love to turn his jersey bright yellow is LeMond's training partner, Australian Phil Anderson. But Anderson rides on the rival Panasonic team, and although his team has worked brilliantly protecting him, he, like the others, must now race alone against the watch. The cyclists leave the start house at 2-minute intervals, so Anderson is left alone with his bike and with the crowd. The Badger, Bernard Hinault, awaits his countdown in the start house. His ability to beat the competition in the race of truth has now become legend. Also on the 45-mile course is Irishman Sean Kelly. He, too, is a specialist at playing beat the clock. A moment to prepare himself, and then the stopwatch starts for Greg LeMond as well. Hinault settles into a rhythm that will have to last for more than 1.5 hours.
The first 15 miles of the race are uphill, making it difficult for the riders to find their pace, including a struggling Phil Anderson trying to keep his rhythm by getting up off the saddle.
Bernard Hinault, dressed like some sort of missile, attacks the course with his teardrop aerodynamic helmet and moon disc wheel, which eliminates the drag caused by conventional spokes.
Phil Anderson has decided the excess weight of the aerodynamic disc wheels was too much to pedal up the first climb, so Anderson used a conventional bike to reach the top, where he executed a planned and legal bike exchange. The change may have cost him 30 seconds, but on this new bike, estimated to be 7 to 8 seconds faster per mile, he will easily regain his losses over the next 30 miles.
Greg LeMond entered this race 1:05 behind overall. The time trial is where the top riders most always shine, but LeMond has begun losing precious seconds on this course.
It's begun to rain, and there's nothing more terrifying than racing on wet roads that can become as slick as ice. And in a time